say after that. I want to thank her, I think Jonathan, I want to thank Cole, all the organizers, too many to mention here today, but I'm very grateful to all the co-sponsors who took the initiative to join together and organize this incredible conference. This is what citizen engagement looks like, and it's really uplifting for me, and I know it was for Senator Markey, to see so many people here on a Saturday afternoon. You know, this morning's panels describe the lay of the land, if you will, of the decision-making that comes into play when we think of the unthinkable. Nuclear war, using a nuclear weapon, a nuclear exchange, and what is the constitutional limits on the president, if any, when it comes to using nuclear weapons. I say unthinkable because for over 70 years, the idea around nuclear deterrence is that we have these terrible destructive nuclear weapons to make sure that we don't use them. They used to call it mad, and it is mad. It's totally insane, but it is still the international framework for restraint. Within that framework, nuclear disarmament treaties, many bilateral, some multilateral, have come into being that have significantly decreased the number of weapons in the U.S. and Russian arsenals, eliminated nuclear above-ground testing and nearly all below-ground testing, curtailed nearly all countries from acquiring or developing nuclear weapons, and restrained those nations that have nuclear weapons from acquiring new ones. These are no small accomplishments, and Congress has enshrined most of these into U.S. law, either by ratifying treaties or by authorizing and funding, implementing, and monitoring programs. And I firmly believe that Congress would not have acted without a very engaged citizenry. So here we are today, and speaking for myself, I don't believe that I've ever been so worried about a possible nuclear confrontation in my life. Using a nuclear weapon can be triggered very quickly and then can escalate so rapidly that before we know it, we are in a nuclear war. As I'm sure you heard this morning, the National Command Authority is very simple. The President makes the decision to use nuclear weapons and the Secretary of Defense executes the order. If that doesn't scare the hell out of you right now, I don't know what will. Once the decision is made and in the process of being carried out, our systems of checks and balances don't apply. Congress couldn't stop it. The Supreme Court couldn't stop it. And the way it's set up, not even the Secretary of Defense, in theory, has the authority to stop it. Quite frankly, this is far from what the framers of the Constitution had in mind when they drafted and adopted this foundation of all our laws and democratic institutions. The framers gave the power to declare war to Congress. And this is the motivation and the reason and the foundation for why H.R. 669 and S-200, the Restricting First Use of Nuclear Weapons Act, were introduced by Congressman Ted Lieu of California and our own Senator Ed Markey, as you heard here today, in January of this year. This bill, let me repeat it again, prohibits the president, and let me be clear, it prohibits any president and every president from using U.S. armed forces to carry out a first use nuclear strike unless Congress has declared war and authorized such a first strike. It's that simple and it's that straightforward. And I'm proud to be an original sponsor, in fact, the very first co-sponsor of the House bill. H.R. 669 has 72 co-sponsors, which is not a bad beginning. But as Senator Markey pointed out, we need to increase the pressure. And here in Massachusetts, we have 9 members of Congress. Two of us are on the bill, myself and Catherine Clark. Everybody else hasn't got on the bill yet. And Elaine began this meeting today by reading all the towns and cities off where everybody's from. You are all in those representatives' districts. Get them on this bill and make a point to call them next week. And I would say, sadly, too, in the House, only one of the co-sponsors is a Republican. And that is my friend and colleague from North Carolina, Walter Jones. This shouldn't be a Democratic or Republican issue. This is a common sense issue. And quite frankly, we need to make sure that everybody feels the pressure. The bill also clearly defines that first strike means an enemy has not launched a nuclear weapon against the United States or an ally of the United States. If another country launches a nuclear weapon at us, the president does have the right to proportionate self-defense under international law. although what that term means might have been discussed earlier today. Some might argue that prohibiting the U.S. from striking first with a nuclear weapon ties the president's hands and makes the U.S. vulnerable to attack. I know the former Secretary of Defense, William Perry, a true champion of rational nuclear disarmament, has noted that there is no scenario where the U.S. military could respond as a first strike with devastating force using our existing conventional arsenal. This includes our B-2 bombers, our cruise missiles, our Tomahawks, our non-nuclear ICBMs, and a huge range of weaponry. We have seen the destructive capacity of our conventional first strike weapons in Iraq and Afghanistan, regardless of what we might individually think about those wars, and I'd like them to be brought to an end as soon as humanly possible. So we are not weak, or we are not vulnerable. We have many options to take the initiative and strike first for retaliation. Nuclear retaliation, let alone first strike, is not needed. And let me say for the record, the Democrats were strongly pushing President Obama to adopt a no first strike policy when he was in office. So this is not just about President Trump. This is something that we have been contemplating for quite some time. But it will take many more co-sponsors, as I said, for this bill to have any chance of moving in the House or the Senate. It will take the Republican leadership of Congress being a lot more nervous about the possibility of the president actually launching a strike for them to advance these bills. And meanwhile, we have the president backing away, as Senator Markey pointed out, from the hard-won international agreements to keep nuclear weapons out of the hands of the Iranians. And we have him exchanging ever more heated taunts with a nuclear-armed North Korea. This is why the Markey-Lew bill is so absolutely necessary. Congress needs to assert its constitutional authority not only when it comes to war, and most especially when it comes to the catastrophic possibility of nuclear war. On North Korea, I'm proud to have also joined with Senator Markey and Representative Conyers to introduce bipartisan, bicameral legislation to reaffirm Congress's constitutional power over a first strike on North Korea. H.R. 4140, the No Unconstitutional Strike Against North Korea Act, was introduced last week with 60 co-sponsors. Two of them are Republicans. The bill restricts any funds from being used to launch a military strike against North Korea without prior approval from Congress. That's any strike, not just a nuclear strike, because war is war is war. And only Congress has the right to declare it and authorize it. I'm very proud to have helped lead a letter addressed to President Trump with my good friends and colleagues, Congressman Conyers and Congresswoman Barbara Lee from California, responding to the president's wildly erratic comments threatening military action against North Korea. We had 64 Democrats sign that letter. At the beginning of October, Congressman Seth Moulton here in Massachusetts helped coordinate a letter also addressed to the president on the same topic, signed by 68 Democrats. That letter described a better approach to North Korea, emphasizing diplomacy, economic pressure, and crisis management. And we don't have the time to go into this, but one of the things that also worries me is that I think President Trump actually believes that we have some kind of missile defense system that will knock out all of North Korea's nuclear weapons out of the sky if they were to launch a nuclear weapon, and there's no such thing exists to be able to guarantee the protection of ourselves and our allies. These current crises, as threatening and as frightening as they are, really speak to the underlying and long unresolved crisis of nuclear weapons themselves. As you know, President Obama began a program of so-called nuclear modernization. President Trump has doubled down on that proposal to modernize, update, and create new nuclear weapons. The Congressional Budget Office, known as CBO, just came out with a report on Wednesday that estimates the cost of President Trump's plans to maintain and replace the U.S. nuclear arsenal over 30 years would cost $1.24 trillion. This is $200 billion more than the last estimate. And when you factor in inflation, the price tag soars to $1.7 trillion. These costs are simply unsustainable. They threaten the entire federal budget, including the rest of the military budget. But what is also important about the CBO, shift in thinking about among the nuclear powers, not just the United States and Russia, but also France, the UK and China, not to mention India, Pakistan, and North Korea, that nuclear arsenals must be protected and updated and increased, with an eye to the inevitable use of a nuclear strike against an enemy in the foreseeable future. The nuclear powers are hunkering down and going in the wrong direction while the rest of the world is moving towards a demand for total nuclear disarmament. Not too long ago, that was at least the future goal of nuclear powers. Careful, verifiable, incremental disarmament, while ensuring that no other nation acquired nuclear weapons capabilities. But I really fear for the current moment. We have members of Congress who think using a nuke against North Korea or Iran is not just something we should think about, they believe it is something we should do. We will really need an engaged citizenry, a large-scale movement to change the direction. As Senator Markey pointed out, the nuclear freeze movement began right here, in Cambridge. I think it's time to get moving again. It's time once again to remind our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, that these are issues that affect every single American family, every single one of us. In a very busy world where families are focused on picking up their kids from school, wondering how the economy is going to affect their jobs and their grocery bills, there is one more sure thing that we all need to remember. A nuclear war will kill us all. Quickly or slowly, it will kill all of us. Nuclear war not only devastates the people where it falls, it would over time devastate the world as we know it. That was once commonly an understood fact, but it's been forgotten in the press, it's been forgotten in the press because so many other crises and other hardships have moved to the forefront. It is time to remind everyone, including every single member of Congress, what the reality is. It is time to rebuild this movement across ages, across regions, across cities, towns, suburbs, rural communities, across genders, across races, because a nuclear war will devastate us all. It's important to remember, though, how different the times are now than when the freeze movement was organized. We no longer have a Democratic Congress. We don't even have a moderate Republican Congress. We have a very conservative Republican-controlled House and Senate that have never moved forward any legislation outside their own narrow agenda. And we have a very unstable, volatile, erratic White House. You know, so this is the moment. You know, in 1978, I was a college intern in the office of Senator George McGovern, no relation, but one of my heroes. And I had the privilege of attending a debate that he had with William F. Buckley Jr. At Yale University. And the debate was entitled, Resolved, that the SALT talks are in the interest of U.S. national security. Senator McGovern concluded his closing remarks by referring to a 1963 debate on the Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. And here's what he said that night at Yale. He closed by saying, he said, Senator Everett Dirksen took to the floor to close the debate. He said that he just reread John Hersey's Hiroshima, the description of what happened to that great city the morning after. The scene of one family sitting charred around the breakfast table, out in the yard, bits and pieces of children's clothing, the broken arm of a doll, toys and debris scattered over the landscape. And he said, I thought about that scene, and I said that someday Everett Dirksen will be buried in Illinois, and when that happens, I don't want them to put on my gravestone, he knew about this and he didn't care. Well, you being here today shows me loudly and clearly that you care. And we need to build this movement, and time is of the essence. Thank you.